Well, good evening. Welcome to St. Augustine Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Tim. It is Good Friday, and somebody asked me, why do we say Good Friday? Well, we're in the Holy Week rhythms. Of course, they start with Palm Sunday, and they finish with Easter Sunday morning. And each of those days we refer to as Holy Monday, Holy Tuesday. It's just a way to set apart those days, remember the rhythms Jesus went through in those last moments on earth. Good is an old word for holy. We keep the word good, though, for Good Friday to set it apart as different than the other days. Some of the St. Augustine folks know that we've been following a text thread for Holy Week. And when you mark the different moments of Good Friday, there are quite a number of moments as Jesus is going through trials at midnight, at 3 a.m., at 5 a.m., at 6 a.m., at 8 a.m. There's trials all morning. By 9 a.m., Jesus is heading towards the crucifixion at Golgotha. By 3 p.m., Jesus dies on the cross. And so here in these moments of Good Friday, if we're sinking into the rhythms with Christ, then we've already recognized that Christ has died, that darkness has set across the land in an early kind of way. These are really fun rhythms to walk through. I use the word fun loosely, of course, because we know the promise of Easter is coming. We know that death is not the end of the story. And so we walk through these rhythms tonight. And last year's cantata, we really remembered the Good Friday piece. We even left in silence if you were with us last year's cantata. This year's cantata is different. We're going to go through the whole Easter story because we know the end of the week from the beginning. We know the whole of the story. You'll see different people bringing in props that help us remember the different parts of the Holy Week story, from the crucifixion to the resurrection. This is a good time to pause before Easter and let ourselves participate in the story. And that's exactly the invitation I want to give before we even start the cantata, is that we participate in the story. It's one thing to tell the story. You know, I tell my kids the story of Easter, the story of Christmas. We teach the story. But it's a whole different matter to participate in the story, to walk with Christ through the death into a new life of resurrection. I wanted to read a passage of Scripture before we started that really helps us get in that zone. It's one of my favorite passages. It's from Romans 6, Romans 6, 4 through 7. The Apostle Paul writes these verses that are really rich for joining Christ in that death into resurrection. Romans 6, verse 4. Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too may walk in newness of life. For if we have become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him in order that our body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be slaves to sin. For the one who has died is freed from sin. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. And it's a good word. It's a good word that invites us to not just hear the story, but participate in it. Let our lives be wrapped up by faith, by God's grace through faith in Christ, that we die to those old ways, let them go, and put our lives in Christ to actually have Easter within us, within our own life. Not just some story in Jerusalem all those years ago, but Easter in us right here, right now. So that's the invitation. There's going to be words on the screen as we go throughout the cantata. Hopefully that helps us all worship together. I know some of us think that we came for a performance. I know you'll get some really good music It's really good. I'm biased. I'm singing in the choir, but it's good. More than that, though, I want us to be in that place of worshiping God together as we follow these rhythms of Easter, death, and resurrection. One of the ways that we do that at St. Augustine Methodist is we have candles that mark the season. We do this for Advent. We light candles as we get closer to Christmas. During Lent, we extinguish candles. Why do we extinguish candles? Well, during Lent, we get closer and closer to Good Friday, remembering the death of Christ, the darkness that surely was felt before the resurrection. On Easter Sunday, we light the Christ candle again. We remember that even in the darkness, the light of Christ always wins. And so throughout Lent, we've been slowly extinguishing the candles on the altar table behind me. And you can see there's only one candle left, only one candle remaining. So I'm going to go ahead and extinguish that before we begin. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, this is your story. Not just some fairy tale, but truly the gospel, good news. Your story passed down to us in Scripture. Your story faithfully proclaimed year after year after year throughout the church history. Father, we've gathered once again to remember the story of Christ's death and resurrection. Holy Spirit, in these moments, we invite you to do a work in our lives. We choose right now to open our hearts to something far more, far deeper than a performance. We choose to open our hearts to that promise of Romans 6, that promise that when we place our lives in Christ by your grace through faith, that we too can die to the old and be born again in resurrection hope to the new. Holy Spirit, we invite you into this place tonight to do that work. It's in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit we pray these things.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
wonderful, victorious day of Easter that we celebrate, it recognizes a plan that God foreordained and set in place before the creation of the world. At just the right time, God Himself stepped out of heaven and into our human history in the person of Jesus of Nazareth. Beginning at the age of 30 and lasting for 3 years, Jesus carried out a very public ministry of teaching and healing. Everywhere He went, crowds gathered, longing to be near Him. Never was this more evident than on the week before His death, as He came riding into Jerusalem on a young donkey. The young and the old rushed to line the streets, waving palm branches and cheering, "Hosanna! Blessed is He who comes in the name of the Lord."
Reclined at the table, a woman came to him with an alabaster jar of expensive perfume. which he poured on his head to anoint his body.
Thank you.
being adored by those that hung on his every word. There were others in Jerusalem, in secret councils, behind closed doors, who had an entirely different response to him. The religious leaders of the day saw him as a threat to their power. They were on the lookout for an opportune moment to seize him, have him wrongly accused, and to put him to death. They found their chance one night in the solitude of a garden where Jesus had gone to pray, and they made their move.
Thank you.
moment of Christ's suffering on a hill outside of the city, the people of Jerusalem were gathering once more to observe the ordained Passover. Just as their parents, their grandparents, and generations for centuries before them had done, each family was bringing to the altar a lamb to be sacrificed as an offering to cover sin. At that very hour when worshipers were packing into the temple and thousands of lambs were being slaughtered, the final once and for all sacrifice was also occurring upon a cross just a short distance away from the temple. Our Savior was doing what millions and millions of animal sacrifices through the ages would never be able to do.
The wrath of God was being fully poured out against all wrongdoing. The blood of our Savior was being poured out by God's design to not just cover sin, but to actually take it away.
Pour out.
the great plan of God, there is one name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. Only one name, only one help, only one hope.
Resurrection of Jesus Christ shines as the ultimate proof of our God's sovereignty. His purpose was perfectly fulfilled in spite of the most evil and despicable plans of sinners and even Satan himself. The worst deed that hell and human depravity could even design, because of God's absolute authority, was used to bring about the greatest good of all time. And so our hearts rightfully rejoice. On that first Easter, hope rises like the morning sun, because darkness cannot win. Death cannot win. Christ has risen. In Christ alone we find life beyond the grave. In Christ alone we find hope brighter than darkness. In Christ alone we find Easter every single day. Try to hide it this year. I let Ryan hide it. I just want to thank Sharon for all her hard work. Can we give Sharon a thank? Yeah. There are a few thank yous that are in order before we part ways. I got to look at the bulletin to point out some things. You know, starting on the back, it is a great joy that this is a community choir. This is not St. Augustine Methodist Church's choir. In fact, we counted. We don't even have enough people to put a choir together for Sunday morning. This choir comes from all over St. Augustine, various churches throughout St. Augustine. I would be remiss if I didn't mention that. The back of your bulletin names those churches. The Cowboy Church, First Baptist Church, the Presbyterian Church, and Grace Church, along with the Methodist Church. We all joined together to put the choir together. And so I just want to thank those churches that we can do that as a community. That's good. Also, this year was different because we've been playing a CD the last few years, but we did not this year. Davy Thomas is our pianist. Yeah. Of course, there's a whole host of people that you saw bringing in props and behind the scenes doing the words on the screen. I do want to recognize Ryan Mason for mixing the sound. That's a hard job, and he did a good job doing that. Are we ready for Easter? I think so. You know, we passed through Saturday, and in the Holy Week rhythms, Saturday is quiet and silent. Now, we just ended with a big bang and the tombs open and all that. But I do want to encourage us as we walk through Saturday. One of the things that happens in Scripture is the disciples don't know. They really think that Jesus has died. They really think on Saturday that Jesus is not who he said he is. That is a heavy, hard day, that day of silence. For us, I got adrenaline pumping. You know, we know Easter's coming. They did not know Easter was coming. And so sitting in that wonder of Christ, that in between Friday and Sunday, as we prepare our hearts for Easter Sunday morning, is right and good. I would like to pray one more time together before we leave. And choir, if y'all could just stay put, we are going to take a picture after everybody leaves. Let's pray once more. God, this is your gospel, this good news. Holy Spirit, we give you thanks for your presence here among us. And yet, we even pray for more grace, that you'd soften our hearts. As families coming in and getting settled, or as we're planning on traveling to be with family, as we're going different ways this Easter Sunday weekend, the different rhythms of the day. Holy Spirit, we invite you to set it apart for us, that we would have open hearts to hear you, to obey you as you call us to die to the old and be born again to the new. For that is where life truly is. And we invite you, God, to do that work, even as we part ways on this Good Friday evening. It's in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit we pray. Amen. Friends, go in peace.